Hello, everyone. I'm Huang Wei from Singapore. So I will host today's talk given by Professor Luke Welwich. So firstly, welcome to come to a combustion webinar. Today, we are very happy to have Professor Luke Welwich to introduce his work on solving the population balance equation for non-inertial particles dynamics using PDF and the machine learning method. Application to soothing flumes. Dr. Luke Welwich is a professor at the National Institute of Applied Sciences, Louvain-Normandy in France, and a researcher at the CNRS Laboratory, Korea. Dr. Luke completed his PhD at Laboratory National Hydraulic in Chateau, Paris in 1991. And he did a postdoc at the Center for Turbine Research, CTR, in Stanford University. His research focuses on turbine reacting flows, combustion, and flames. And Dr. Luke was awarded a senior research position at the Institute, Université de France, in 2014, and the Prix Jaffé of the French Academy of Sciences in 2015. He is currently a member of the Scientific Council of IFP Energies, NOVAS, and the DFG, Mercator Fellow at Simulation of Reactive Thermal Fluid System at TU Darmstadt in Germany. So now we give the time to Professor Luke. Professor Luke, please.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure to participate to these combustion webinars. And I'm very grateful to the organizers for providing me the opportunity to talk to you today. I'm going to discuss recent works performed at INSAR Rouen Normandy and CNRS Korea on the simulation of distribution of sizes of non-inertial particles by solving for the population balance equation, along with the applications to soothing flames. This study is supported by Safran Aircraft Engines, the French National Association for Technological Research, and the Soprano EC project. The co-authors of this work are Dr. Andrea Sells, Dr. Alexandre Bouanich, and Dr. Pascal Domingo. Both Andrea and Alexandre actually completed their PhD on this subject. I'd like also to thank Dr. Alain Kerr, who followed Andrea's PhD at Safran, and Nicolas Perret and Mathieu Houillon from Solvay, who introduced me a few years ago to the numerical issues going with the solving of PBE for liquid flows, and this then led to the work I'm going to discuss today. Okay. Looks like the slides are not progressing. Oh yeah, okay. First, a few words about the context. So flow carrying non-inertial particles are observed in many processes, both in chemical and mechanical engineering. These particles are assumed to be small enough to follow the flow with a negligible amount of drag. In gaseous flow, typical applications are carbon black deposit and soothing flames. In liquid flow, crystallization, which start from the nucleation of solid particles, followed by particle surface growth, agglomeration, and eventually breakage. This is another example. In any case, what is very peculiar with this problem is a large range of size covered by the particle, from vanishing diameter up to a tenth of micrometer. And simulating all of these scales, in addition to the turbulent flow scales, it's not going to be an easy task, right? So the quantity to address non-inertial flowing particles is a number of particles per unit of volume and per unit of size, small n in this equation. Integrating this number density over all possible sizes return NT, the total number of particles per unit of flow volume at a given point and time. Small L is defined versus the characteristic particle size, which may be the volume, V, or the diameter, D. And plotting N versus this characteristic measure of the size allows for studying the particle size distribution, as you can see in this graph. And knowing this PSD is essential in processes where particles below or above threshold size are expected. So you see here an example of carbon particles or soot, particle size distribution as measured by Kempenaer and Long in a diffusion flame. You see that the shape of the particle size distribution evolves with the position within the flame, along with the range of sizes observed depending on the fuel rich or fuel lean character of the mixture. Returning such an information from a numerical simulation for a real combustion chamber, therefore accounting for complex chemistry and complex geometries, is the objective of this work. Actually, in a swirl burner, soot production can be accurately controlled or even avoided. You see here various swirling flames by my colleagues in the lab, Maxime Bouvier and Frédéric Grisch, within the Soprano European project. The burner is similar to the stratified burner by Simon Hochgreb in Cambridge University, UK, with the central bluff body, two co-flowing annular premix fuel jets, and two different equivalence ratios. The external fuel jet is swirling. Varying the swirl intensity and the fuel air ratio, a diagram may be built to delineate between weakly or highly sooting flames. Of course, turbulent mixing is here a key parameter, and larger dissimulation can help for the design of real system using those swirl burner. But to do that, we need to benefit from reliable numerical method and framework to integrate all the complexity of soot modeling in order to introduce the soot modeling in those high fidelity, larger dissimulation. This is the objective of this work. As you certainly know, the thermophysics of soot is terribly complex. And I'm not an expert in this field, therefore I let it to the professional for this part. And our objective is to develop a numerical framework which can handle up-to-date or best description of chemistry and particle dynamics for predicting the nucleation controlled by pH, surface growth, loss, oxidation, and agglomeration. We are aware of the fact that there's no definitive answers for many of these processes. It's progressing every day. But we think that having a reliable numerics to test these models in real flame is mandatory, actually, to progress. The balance equation for the particle number density, N, may be derived from first principle. It includes a usual convective term, a term representative of particle surface growth or loss, and a source or sink of particle at a given size. This source or sink includes the nucleation of particles, new ones, and the apparition of particles of size V because of agglomeration. And agglomeration is usually expressed with a Smoluchowski equation, as done here. Note that the convective term in size space is a nonlinear term that depends on the velocity g. So the particle size distribution is going to be convected, displaced toward larger size or smaller size, depending on the size of G, without modification of its shape in principle. This is a nonlinear term, and the speed g may depend on the thermophysical properties of the problem studied. So there are three major difficulties when dealing with population balance equation on the computer. As we have seen, the physics behind the phase change and the evolution of the particle surface is usually complex and not fully explored. Important modeling assumptions are formulated to express the kinetics of nucleation and surface growth or loss. And the same applies to coagulation, agglomeration, and breakage. Once these hypotheses are formulated, the range of sizes is large. And considering all the potential sizes simultaneously is numerically costly. And third, but not least, the specific form of the equation by itself makes it prone to numerical oscillation, and expansive numerics must be used to secure accuracy. In fact, accurate and reliable numerical methods do exist to solve for the PBE, if you go searching into the literature. But those high fidelity simulations with population balance equation have been mostly limited to canonical flows so far, simply because of the cost, which is associated to the numerical treatment required to predict the PSD evolution with precision. Okay, along this line, the objective of the present work is to use one of these precise methods recently developed to train a set of neural networks for solving the PBE in complex three-dimensional turbulent flows. Starting from a large database of PBE solutions generated from stochastic turbulent mixing problems or canonical laminar flame, the neural networks are trained to predict the dynamics of the homogeneous flow part of the PBE, therefore surface growth, loss, nucleation, and agglomeration. And then this network is coupled with CFD to predict soot in a three-dimensional unsteady flow, such as the combustion chamber of an aircraft engine. So the quantity of interest for the neural networks will be the particle number density integrated over section of size. This quantity, any, will be transported by the flow solver to account for convection, whereas the neural networks will provide the source representative of the particle dynamics. In practice, the neural network can even be trained to directly update the particle number density after its convection by the flow. Then we use a fractional step approach. Note that the PDF of size is introduced in our analysis to ease the neural network training with a novel stochastic approach that I'm going to discuss now. And the reference database is generated, solving for both NT, the total number of particles per unit volume, and P, the PDF of size, instead of solving for directly NV. We will see that actually decomposing the problem in two parts brings a lot of advantages. Indeed, with this approach, where the PDF evolution is solved with stochastic particles, surface growth loss is linearized, improving significantly the accuracy of the PBE solution used for training the neural networks. So the starting point is thus the equation for the PBE. We integrate this equation, we obtain the balance equation for the total number of particles per unit volume with a source term reorganized here to make it proportional to this total number NT. And the PDF of particle size is simply the ratio between the number of particles at a given size divided by the total number of particles. And now from those three relations, you can derive a balanced equation for the PDF of size. So it is different from the usual PDF equations that we know in turbulent combustion modeling for scala, simply because size is not a conserved quantity, but still the PDF is integrates to unity when you integrate over all the particle size, right? So the flux in size space behaves like in the PBE. It's convecting the distribution in size space without changing its shape, where the source is twofold. It creates new probability because of new particle at a given size, or particle disappearing for this size because of agglomeration, or because of breakage or anything. Plus a term that actually redistributes the PDF to preserve its normalization so that the PDF integrates to unity. So you could wonder, why is it interesting to introduce this PDF instead of working directly with NV? It's the fact that the PDF has to integrate to unity. If you have something that the probability that a function that integrates to unity, if you want to build a Monte Carlo solution with a fixed number of particles, it's straightforward. If you have something that that does not integrate to unity, it's much more complicated practically. So how do we do that? The PDF is discretized in a set of Monte Carlo particles. Then convection in size space, growth or oxidation becomes linear. It's very easy to integrate without any numerical diffusion as chemical sources in PDF method for turbulent flames. For nucleation and agglomeration, it's also a very simple process. If you know from a physical model the amplitude of the source A at the size V star, we just need to compute the number of particles which require to be changed according to this source. We store all the particles with negative sources after selecting them randomly and redistribute them also randomly at sizes for which the source is positive. To do this and to compute the source, the sample space variable V star is discretized in sections. It's a very simple process. However, it is only for an infinite number of stochastic particles that the method is fully exact. But infinity is a large number. So what we do to reduce the total number of stochastic particles, still preserving accuracy, is to store the residual arising when the source is transformed into an integer number of particles and transport this residual with a kind of sectional approach only for the growth part. We accumulate it up to a point where it is large enough to be redistributed over the particle. So in practice, we have the stochastic particles. We count the number of stochastic particles which are within a given section. Notice that the stochastic particles can evolve independently of the section. So they don't see the section when they move around. But when we need to estimate agglomeration or to compute a source term, we construct sections. So we count the number of particles within one section. Then, of course, this scan with a total number of particle per unit volume, you go back to the particle number density for this section. So you can plot the PSD. You can apply agglomeration to get the source term. So for that, we use the method proposed by Herbele et al. A few years ago. And then you have the number of particles that must change because of this source. Then you take the integral part of it. And for this integral part, you can reallocate the particle, selecting them randomly. But then it changes, of course, the PSD, but there is a residual. So if the total number of particles goes to infinity, this residual is very small. But if you start decreasing the number of particles to preserve the same accuracy, what we do is we store this real number and we just apply growth to it when we need to iterate with the method. And then when the residual is large enough, you can redistribute it over the particle. So if you do this, you end up with an hybrid sectional stochastic method or stochastic sectional method, which is very precise for growth. So in the case of soot, for the growth and of the oxidation of soot, right? So you see here an example. So what we did is we tested it for pure growth. This is a very difficult test case because what you have to, your numerical method then should be able to convect a Dirac delta function, right? And everything that goes away from this Dirac function is numerical noise. So on the left, you can see the stochastic particles in blue, convected in psi space along with the reconstructed section in black. On the right, the PSD evolution. In black, this novel approach. In blue and red, you can see how large is in fact the impact of numerical diffusion with 2 or 3 point sectional methods. As I said, here you should see the convection of a Dirac function, but with a usual sectional method, what you have is a distribution instead of the Dirac. Therefore, calibrating a physical model with such a level of diffusion would be highly questionable if you start looking at the shape of your PSD, specifically if you deal with nucleation and oxidation. We can play a crucial role in combustion system with multi-point injection, stratified injection, and secondary air dilution. Well, if this approach seems interesting to you, I invite you to check our recent chemical engineering science paper where tests of this hybrid method are reported concerning convergence, stability, and comparison against an identical solution, including growth, oxidation, and agglomeration. And actually, I think it would be nice to see numerical method for soot systematically going through these elementary tests and preliminary evaluation to avoid calibrating the physical models with numerical error compensation. Okay, back to the neural network now that will be trained with this PBE solving approach. These neural networks are built from a combination of a large number of elementary linear functions. So they offer nonlinear interpolation capabilities. You have basically two options. Coefficients of the elementary functions, therefore the neurons, can be optimized to match given outputs from given inputs. In the end, machine learning is then simply nonlinear interpolations. But in some cases, as with the so-called deep learning, we add to these operations, such as filtering, which are applied to the database, to seek out its principal features, and then the neural networks can associate output to these features of the data. This approach is particularly suited to distributions. It was first proposed for images, but a distribution like the PSD can be seen as a one-dimensional image, and this is what we will be using for the PSD. So we will combine these approaches of artificial intelligence, if you wish. The INN part, therefore an interpolation, will deal with the thermochemical part controlling nucleation, growth, etc. So it will inform the neural network on the physical parameter controlling the dynamics of the surface chemistry of soot and how they agglomerate, while a convolutional neural network will be used for the particle size distribution. In addition, to better capture the dynamics of the system, both networks are augmented with one additional short-term memory neural layer, which is calibrated over 5 iterations to account for the time history of the population balance equation solving. So the flow chart of the method looks like this. The thermochemical variables and the time step are the inputs of the artificial neural network. The PSD at time t is the input of the convolutional neural network. Their outputs are concatenated to predict the PSD at time t plus delta t. Therefore, the model must be trained for a set of time steps. Here, these time steps are almost uniformly distributed between 2.5 microseconds and 75 microseconds. Okay, to start testing this procedure, one-dimensional laminar soothing flame is simulated. The chemistry is detailed and very standard modeling is introduced for the carbon solid phase. The objective here is clearly not to better perform than previous modeling, but to return similar results with a significant CPU reduction, so that then we can actually apply this to much more complex flows like a real combustion system. So for this particular case, the species representative of the oxidation for the fuel, including the radical OH and of a major soot precursor, here the pyrene, together with temperature enter the ANN with the time step. 5 iterations are kept. The PSD enter the CNN, 100 neurons accounting for the time history over 5 iterations are connected to 60 neurons for both ENN and CNN. After concatenation, down to 10 neurons are used for outputting the particle number density at the subsequent time step. The inputs are normalized, and for the PSD, the output goes through 15 layers of convolutional filters with a dropout rate of 10%. And the 60 neuron layers is a dense layer. And the dense layer is driven by the same formulas as the linear layers, but the end result is passed through a nonlinear activation function. So we have this model and we train it and then we apply it to the CFD. So the training is performed on a database obtained from the hybrid stochastic sectional method solving for the PDF of psi, so the method as I previously described. And the neural network can be trained to subsequently operate with either the same number of sections than in the reference simulation, the training database, or with less sections to save CPU time. However, even when less sections are used, the information contained in the highly resolved simulation has been seen and learned by the neural network. So you can basically reduce the number of sections you transport in the flow solver, but their source term will have been learned from a simulation, a canonical problem where much more sections have been taken into account. So there's more physics in your source term, even though there's less sections. So you see here the PSD at different positions through the one-dimensional reference ethylene flame by Zhao et al., which is a standard test case for soothing flame. The training was performed on the laminar flame for the same operating condition. And the simulations with the neural networks are with source term reconstructed for the number density so that interpolation errors can accumulate. So it is an a posteriori test. We do not just read, we let the thing run and go through the flame. The temperature profile is imposed as usual when we test model for soot in this one-dimensional flame. So in blue, you see the reference training simulation. In red, it's projection to reduce number of sections. In gray, the Monte Carlo reference simulation by Zhao and co-workers, noting that this is a direct Monte Carlo simulation of the physics, not of a balanced equation as in our approach. Therefore, the gray line can be seen as a CPU intensive reference simulation of the particle dynamics. In black, the results of our a posteriori simulation with the neural networks using 30 sections, and in red, with only 10 sections, but trained with 30 sections. We see that a good agreement is obtained between all the simulation, and in particular against the reference simulation using a physical Monte Carlo approach by Zhao et al. However, it would be interesting to compare against experiment. Well, when we started to work on that, we were wondering whether it would be necessary to make sure that we are not comparing oranges with against potatoes, right? Actually, in the numerical simulation of soot particles, we assume that the soot are spherical. In the real world, however, the experimentalists are telling us that they are not spherical at all, even for small diameters. This is one problem. Moreover, when the measurements are performed with SMPS, it is a mobility diameter which is measured. So what we need actually is to relate the mobility diameter, which is measured experimentally, to the sphere diameter that we have in the modeling. And in fact, directly comparing does not make much sense. If you add this to the possible numerical diffusion mentioned previously and impacting on the PSD, this is actually a lot of uncertainty to deal with to carefully calibrate modeling, right? This is what we need to be very clean, at least on the numerical part. Now, we had a look at this problem with our colleague, Jérôme Mion, here at INSA. So what we did is to explore this by first using a semi-empirical closure developed by Jérôme. And this semi-empirical closure is relating an equivalent sphere diameter to the mobility diameter. Then we can also improve the agglomeration source modeling by estimating the collision diameter from a gyration diameter, which come actually from a fractal law. In this fractal law, there's a few parameters that you can determine, and the primary spherical diameter is a key parameter. So you can see here the experimental PSD for various assumed initial DP, the primary spherical diameter. And you see that, so taking the SMPS and going through this process. Decreasing DP, the particle size distribution moves towards larger size. Indeed, for small values of DP, the aggregates are more open, and DC, the collision diameter, increases, which in turn increases collision rate, in particular in the free molecular regime. And the distribution is therefore shifted toward larger particles. The same is observed in both experiments and simulation. And for some values, they do match, which is at least hopefully a good result. The same actually is observed for the soot volume fraction. For the lower value of DP, the reactive surface available for C2H2 addition with our modeling is higher, which explains higher value of the volume fraction. What is interesting here is the sensitivity to DP, and of course the fact that there exists a range of DP for which both experiments and simulation get closer. Bivariate or even trivariate modeling, as developed by Patterson and Kraft and Blocker and Pitch, could constitute an interesting alternative to calculate DP. Well, the takeaway here is the fact that it may be dangerous to tune the full numerical model on the SMPS measurements only. I think we need systematically to perform sensitivity analysis on this primary spheroid diameter. Okay, let's go back to the numerical part. So the CPU gain is now examined, and the reference is taken from the hybrid stochastic sectional method, the sectional method with a simple two-point discretization for the gross term is faster, still losing accuracy. So this is without any neural network, right? However, the neural network approach allows for being up to 6 times faster for the very same precision than the reference 30 section solution. The exercise was pushed up to 100 sections, as seen in this graph. A very rapid growth in CPU time is observed for the hybrid and sectional methods, while the cost for the INN stays very moderate, simply because the number of operations, for instance, for computing agglomeration, which rapidly increases with the number of sections, is here completely avoided. This is running on GPU and CPU using mainstream open source software for building neural networks. Okay, so now that we have this method, we wanted to give it a try to a real three-dimensional unsteady flow. And so the method is now applied to a test rig representative of an aeronautical combustion chamber. This is the Mermoz project by ONERA, the French aerospace lab. The objective is to calibrate both experimentally and numerically the particle sizes in the exhaust gases. The conditions are varied to mimic landing and takeoff cycles. So far, we've been running only one point in which is available on the experiment. There's a question about the chemistry here, right? So they burn kerosene in the rig. So we decided to describe the detailed chemistry for kerosene using iChem by Wang and co-workers from Stanford University. We first reduce this chemistry for the present operating condition. We have a package to do that, that I will describe rapidly. It leads to 32 species and 8 species in quasi-steady state. So we transport 32 species and 8 are in quasi-steady state. And then on the top of this, we add 10 transported suit section plus the INN CNN. And the training that I will describe also is performed aside from the CFD. It's based on the kind of zero dimensional PDF solver, PDF for Scala, like the Pope method. So we use the Subramaniam and Pope micromixing model, but applying the specific engine operating condition. So therefore, the training of the neural network is here performed simultaneously with the chemistry reduction, and it's prior and aside from any flow simulation. This is really a pre-processing tool. So to reduce this iChem chemistry and generate the source database for training the neural network, a huge set of fluid particle chemical composition undergoing turbulent mixing and reaction are considered. So we solve for the mixing problem and the reaction. And we solve also for the PDF of size within every stochastic particles, which where here the stochastic particle is actually not a soot part, not representative of the PDF of soot, but the PDF for the fluid particle, right? So we inject in a given reactor the fuel, liquid fuel, the air, and eventually burn gases also, and they will mix and react. So the It is like considering a large set of 0D reactor with a characteristic mixing time distribution versus residence time obtained from CFD. So we can get this information from a preliminary CFD. So that the evolutions are representative of the real flow with liquid fuel injection, primary and staged secondary air with recirculating burn products. These synthetic turbulent distribution are used to probe the turbulent chemistry interaction in order to both reduce chemistry and train the neural network with a collection of soot within every stochastic fluid particles. Okay, and here is some pictures for our Japanese friend from Miyazaki. And this is typically a level of refinement which cannot be coupled with unsteady CFD without relying to the neural network. Okay, so for the chemistry reduction, we combine very well established method. This is very standard now. And I just want to mention that you can also get the chemistry in the form of a neural network or in the form of usual Arrhenius law, and both can be coupled with the CFD. So you can do the neural network for the PDF of size of the soot particles and transport the chemistry with the Arrhenius law, and you can also generate neural network for pre-integrating the chemistry, and this is what KD1 did for actually a syngas turbulent mixing layer, and it was quite efficient and successful. So you can extend the system up to directly reducing and generating a neural network for the chemistry. This is all the species we have kept. So you see here the transported species, the species that we get from the QSS, so the analytically resolved species. Remember that I came with PEH initially, there's 203 species, we get down to 32. And the target to do this reduction are the fuel, the temperature, O2, OH, and two molecules which are important for the soot modeling, C2H2 and C16H10. C2H2 was quite trivial, C16H10, it took some time to figure out that we had to add this one to have a reduction which can deal with all the range of equivalence ratio that we had in the problem. Okay. So for the present operating condition, we have 32 transported species and 8 QSS chemistry. And if now we look at our homogeneous 0D reactor with those various inlets from the fuel, from the air, for the various species, actually, if we look at all the scatter plots, it's too much information. So what we are used to do is to apply the linear mean square estimation mixing model by César de Pazzo on the top of the stochastic particle for the fluid that we have, and then we can generate a trajectory that we call deterministic trajectory, where you compute the local mean summing all over your stochastic particle, right? And then if you do that, you can get an ID directly comparing the same procedure with detailed chemistry and with the reduced chemistry. And we see here that the reduced chemistry is doing nicely. Yeah? The symbol are the detailed chemistry. And even for pyrene, it's not perfect, but getting perfectly pyrene with 32 species, it's impossible, right? So it's not far from the detailed chemistry, and at least it's close enough to allow for driving the soot model. Okay, so this is a pyrene that will enter the soot model. So this movie shows the flow dynamics downstream of injection through the time evolution of CO2 mass fraction. The large D simulation is performed with a low Mach number ES2 flow solver. Here, the dynamic version of the thickened flame LES model is used with a fractional step approach for the soot number density over the section. So it means that what we do, we solve for convection and turbulent diffusion for the particle number density in a fractional step approach. And then we enter the intermediate value into the neural network and we get the one at T plus delta T. Of course, many, many questions are left concerning the subgrid scale transport of the number density. Here, what we do is we just apply what is done for scalar usually. At least we have a tool now to address all of these issues for real flow. The resolution is between 600 micrometer and 6 millimeter. And the geometry of the injection system stays confidential along with a few other things. You see here the total number of particles per unit of volume on the left and the soot volume mass fraction. This simulation allows to visualize where soot is formed and how they are transported by the flow motions. It is thus possible to focus on a specific particle size for regulation requirements. Well, the very first comparison against the measurements are quite encouraging considering the complexity of the problem addressed. Both the soot volume mass fraction and their mean diameter is predicted with a reasonable error level. However, many details need further investigation. And what we are doing now is to simulate the stratified burner that we have in the lab, where we'll be able there to have much more information on the PSD of the soot and do a comparison which will be exhaustive on the quality of the model. Okay, so I'm coming to the end. So machine learning approaches, they appear as an additional brick. It's useful to tackle the modeling of multiphysics and complex flows. But please notice that it is only an additional tool in the modeling loop. And in this work, this tool does not replace at all the physical modeling, okay? In other words, machine learning is just a convenient way of casting the physical problem on the computer. And I would like to mention that the same can be achieved for post-processing high fidelity measurements. This is what we did with Rob Barlow on the combustion regime in collaboration with a group of Christian Hasse in Darmstadt. And it can be used also directly to reduce and pre-integrate chemistry, which is quite nice. I should mention that in the simulation you've seen just before, the aircraft engine, if we compare the CPU cost with chemistry and with chemistry plus the soot, the ratio is 1.4. So the increase adding all the complexity of the soot is less than twice. It's less than 50%. It's just 40%. So that's quite encouraging. Okay, thanks for listening. I hope to see you soon in 3D, not only in 2D. And if you have questions, comments, and remarks, I would be pleased to talk to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Luke, giving us a very interesting talk and introduce a novel way to model the soothing flames. So we got a series of questions from the audience. So next is the Q&A session. But I suggest we have a 5 minutes break and then we move to the questions. So the first question is from Professor Jian Gao from Purdue. So he was asking, are you emphasizing laminar flames or turbulent flames?
Well, it can be applied to both, actually laminar and turbulent flames. We should certainly perform further validations on the laminar flame first.
Okay.
Before going to the turbulent one, because as I mentioned, when we add the turbulent transport, there's a lot of uncertainties. Mm-hmm. And here I know that some colleagues are working on the DNS to try to understand how we need to model those suit transport terms in turbulent flames. So far, what we've done here is very basic. So I think we should, at the same time, perform further validation on the laminar flame and try to understand how what is the impact of turbulent transport on soot to be able then to apply the model to turbulent flame.
Okay, thank you. So his second question is, are you emphasizing real-world three-dimensional gas turbine combustion and aiming to estimate exhaust soot volume fractions?
Actually, the model that we have developed is going to be applied to a real three-dimensional gas turbine. So what you've seen here with the Onera test rig is very close to the real configuration, right? And we did it with a code that is used by Safran to design their three-dimensional burners. So, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. So the next question is from Professor Xiaolong Gou in Chongqing University. So he asking, when using artificial neural networks to model the combustion process, how to analyze the reaction paths?
Yeah, actually, here, maybe I should give more information. We use the usual method like DRGP or PCA or everything that exists in the literature to determine which are the most important species and which are the reaction paths. And from that, we can train the neural network. But I'm not aware of a way from the neural network to analyze the chemistry by itself. You really have to see the neural network just as a way to cleverly tabulate or solve the tabulate or learn how was solved the chemistry. But you cannot analyze the chemistry. You need to use standard method to analyze the chemistry.
Okay. So the next one is from Professor Shuo Yang from University of Minnesota. He is very interested in your work. So he asked several questions. So the first one is the thermophoresis considered in the convection term? Thermophoresis effect.
Yeah. It's included in the laminar flame, but not in the turbulent one.
Okay. So the next one, as the PSD evolves, do you redistribute the MC particles every step or every several steps?
We do it every step. And this is the advantage of the neural network. So of course, when we do the training, we can pay for every step because the training can last for a day. I mean, you don't care, it's just something that runs on the background. You prepare your CFD and it's okay. Now, for when we do the simulation, because there's almost no cost, you just read in the neural network, you can update every time step.
You should.
Otherwise, I guess we didn't try it actually to relax a bit by doing it every two or three time step. But I guess that if we do that, there will be a departure. Remember, it's an important point that it's maybe a weak point of our method. The time step enters the neural network.
Okay, so, thank you.
We need to interpolate between this solution within the neural network for a given time step. So we need to do it every iteration.
Okay, thank you. So the next one is for the coupling of convection term and soot source terms, do you use any splitting scheme? Is there any known issues for your splitting scheme for your problems?
You mean between the chemical and
the convection, yeah.
And the convection, yeah. Actually, when we do the 3D flow or the one-dimensional flame, because it's very different. When we do the 3D flow, we do the splitting. So we solve force for convection and diffusion of the number density, and then we read in the neural, in the neural network the next PSD. When we do it with the laminar flame, actually, when we use the neural network, we do the same. But when we do the training with the hybrid stochastic method, everything is coupled.
Okay.
And so there's it's fully explicit. The simulation is fully coupled and fully explicit.
Okay, thank you. So the next one is, what is the reason for choosing ANN for thermochemical and CNN for PSD?
Yeah, okay. Actually, well, this is interesting because this is a question we usually get because I'm not clear enough here. It's my fault. The we do not solve for the soot part, right?
Okay.
The thermochemistry part. When I'm saying thermochemistry, I'm talking about the information that we need to compute growth and agglomeration, right? So those parameters that enter the ENN, then the CNN sees the PSD, and they are combined to provide the next PSD. But we do not solve for the thermochemistry using the ENN within the same model, right? You can use separate ENN to do the thermochemistry. But the ENN part that deals with thermochemistry within the PSD is just to have information for the PSD to know what are the control parameters of the soup problems. But we do not advance in time the thermochemical part with this ENN that goes with the CNN.
Okay,
it's
thanks.
Just a way to feed the CNN with more information.
Okay, thank you. So the next one is still from Soyan. So he was asking, so could you please provide more details about the hybrid MC and sectional method?
Let's put it this way. You once you have written the PDF for the particle size, you write a usual Monte Carlo method for the particle size. And then you need to compute those agglomeration terms. And to compute those agglomeration terms, we decided to use the formulation that people use in sectional method.
Yeah.
So we have to look at those particles, how they behave in sections, and then apply the source term, and then transfer that to the Monte Carlo approach. All the details and test case against analytical solutions are given in the chemical engineering paper by Alexandre Bouanich.
Okay, thank you. So the next one is, can you please provide some comments on the database selection for your training, for your AI training, using standard 1D laminar premixed diffusion shooting flames, like in FlameNet or in any flames. His concern is that even one-dimensional laminar shooting flames are not that cheap to simulate. Then whether you can have sufficient data for training. This is a general question for AI.
That's a good point. Actually, for the 3D turbulent flows, I don't believe in training with laminar flame. I think we should train with a turbulent mixing model and method as we did. So for the three-dimensional flow, turbulent flow, we didn't use any laminar flame, right? The training is done with a micro-mixing model.
Yeah.
Now for the laminar flame, it makes sense, I mean, to train on the same type of equivalence ratio evolutions through the burner, through the flame, I mean. And so we did use a laminar flame. But I don't think you can generate all the conditions that you see. You know, the problem with neural network is to have a database where you populate the composition space with all the possibilities that you have in your real system. So to do that, the best way is to use a stochastic approach with a Monte Carlo solution. And then you populate your concentrations, and then you can train so that when you are in a given turbulent flow, the conditions you see are close to conditions you've seen before. And it's very unlikely that those conditions will be those of a laminar flame. The laminar flame is certainly a mandatory step to understand the physics and to check the validity of the method, but it may not be the best model in 3D turbulent flows. It's, you know, it's like with flamelets for, it's the same problem, right? You can build nice three-dimensional flamelet modeling, but you need quite a lot of control parameters so that it works perfectly well. It's the same. And with soot, it's even more complex. So this is why here we decided, because it's a non-premix problem with liquid fuel injection, we decided to go with a stochastic micromixing approach.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hi, Luke, can I weigh in one follow-up? So do you mean you actually do the training on the fly through the simulation? Does it only consider the...
No, we don't do the training on the fly. We have built a method that solves for PDF of the scalar field for conditions which are representative of the one that you will have in a three-dimensional flow. And this is what we use for training. It's in a combustion and flame paper by Jawen et al. You have all the details on how, actually we started to do that to be able to probe chemistry for chemistry reduction, to do a chemistry reduction which was representative of the operating conditions that you have on a given three-dimensional problem. And then we use it now to train the neural network. But
okay, thanks.
But you know, in these problems, you have the time history of micromixing. And what we can do is we can extract the time history of the mixing time when you go roughly from inlet to outlet from a preliminary CFD, and then you put that in your reactor to do the training.
Okay, thank you.
There is to have more detail, there is also a paper by KD1 in combustion and flame recently, where we explain how we do the training of neural network based on those stochastic approaches, not for soot, but for chemistry.
So due to a time limitation, we will have one question, okay. So last but not the least, it is from the audience, okay. As the ANN being applied to LES directly so that we may predict the LES flow field based on the Rance reacting flow field?
Yes, there is a very nice work by K. Luo in England. You can find the paper on the internet where they actually use a convolutional neural network, which is fed by a three-dimensional LES from a given number of time step. And then the simulation continues with only the convolutional neural network. And it seems okay in terms of statistics, etc. Now, this is nice. This is a demonstration. I don't know how generic can it be, you know? I tend to believe in the Navier-Stokes equations and the balance equation for aerothermochemistry. Okay. And today, I think that neural network and convolutional network are nice to help, as I show, to reduce CPU time for submodel. Now, being able to have a neural network that predicts all kind of flows with all kind of boundary condition and geometries, I'm not sure. But people are working on that. Yeah. There's also, you know, people trying to replace the numerical method by approximation with neural network. This can be interesting for high order method, for instance, SD or discontinuous Galerkin method, which are very accurate but expensive. If you could reduce the CPU time by having a neural network doing the numerical part, maybe. But this is still a long way to go. For for having something which is practical today, I think the best is to focus on trying to replace a physical model that we know well, that we know will cost too much to be applied in 3D by a neural network.
Okay. So thank you very much, Professor Luke. So if I, due to the time limitation, if I miss some questions, you may want to directly communicate with Professor Luke.
Yeah. And I would like to mention that all the codes I've discussed about the training and all the things, they can be found as a supplementary material of the paper by KD1. Okay. And also on my website, you can download the code for the hybrid and the hybrid stochastic sectional method.
Okay, so they are open source, right?
You can directly try. And if you have a question, don't hesitate to contact me.